Hi, my name is Ryan Jespersen. I've been in the streaming industry for over 15 years with companies like Wowza and now with Millicast. And I'm currently in transit at the Barcelona airport and recording it from here. So just a pleasure to have you all. And today I'm going to talk about WebRTC and whipping WebRTC into shape. And let's face it, the history between WebRTC and the broadcast world has not exactly been a love affair. In its history, WebRTC hasn't been perceived as a viable option for streaming media. It won't work. It won't scale. It's webcam quality at best. Google Stadia was instrumental in showing that extremely high quality at scale and extremely low latency really is possible. And the streaming industry has also decided that use cases which require less than 5 seconds of latency fall into this live bucket. And some fringe use cases that require 3 seconds or less would fall into this new kind of all or ultra low latency bucket. In an industry that's really dominated by VOD models like Netflix, Hulu, HBO, Disney, who really wants or even needs real-time video? But the pandemic has really changed all of this. It's accelerated the adoption of real-time workflows that have finally bridged the gap between web and broadcast. Real-time media has enabled a new form of interactivity with these exciting new use cases that make professional-grade workflows possible on consumer-grade devices over the public internet. WebRTC handles real-time video perfectly. It's what it was designed for. But when you try to plug in external media sources for enabling these mixed-use cases, we start to have a real problem. From the broadcasting industry perspective, WebRTC is just not complete. It lacks a standard signaling protocol that can be implemented once and forgotten, like many other protocols that have come before it. From the web industry perspective, it's a wanted feature, and it would allow the protocol to be used for vastly different use cases than what was originally anticipated or designed. For the broadcast industry, RTMP is still ubiquitous for live streaming, but more importantly for media ingest into hundreds, if not thousands, of media platforms, Mux, wink wink, YouTube, Live, Vimeo, Twitch, Wowza, you know, the list goes on. But WebRTC offers a lot of technical advantages over these older real-time protocols still in use, like RTMP or RTSP, especially when it comes to resiliency over bad network conditions, adaptability, security by default, better codecs like AV1 SVC or HEVC, and so on and so forth. So it's also a web standard, with both the IETF and W3C ratifying WebRTC as a standard earlier this year, which makes client applications, writing client applications for it, so much easier. But really, this lack of standard signaling protocol has historically made it hard to support for software solutions, completely unbearable for hardware encoders to support. And it means that we have lacked the amount of common tools available to the broadcasting world, FFmpeg, VLC, OBS, hardware encoders. And each vendor has ended up creating their own tools for ingesting content to their media servers or integrating plain RTP or RTMP endpoints and doing translation and transcoding between protocols, losing most of the properties that WebRTC enables end-to-end. So by design, WebRTC does not specify a signaling protocol. It leaves it up to the application to choose which one works best for them. And this has been proven very successful for like siloed services where you have full control of clients and servers and interoperability or interconnection between services is just not a requirement. Some protocols like FTL have tried to adapt it to bypass the problem. Some others like SRT have tried to re-implement resiliency and adaptability on top of a different protocol to end up with something better than RTMP. But the reality is none of these are standards. Others like Amazon or FFmpeg are really peeling down WebRTC to rule RTP, which maintains the real-time and resiliency features, but at the cost of encryption, interoperability, and other interesting features that WebRTC brings to the table. So at Cosmo, we've been dealing with the problem for quite a few years, and we decided to fork OBS Studio and create an OBS WebRTC version that could be used to broadcast native WebRTC into one of our customer services. That meant we had to implement a custom protocol for signaling in addition to integrating OBS with libWebRTC. And the first time we did this, it was fun. The second time we did it, we had to support a different media server while keeping compatibility with our first integration. And it was a challenge, to say the least. And doing a third and fourth time was just truly exhausting. And it's a nightmare to maintain and upgrade to new versions of OBS and libWebRTC. And when my colleague Sergio had to do it a fifth time, he decided enough was enough. He knew he had to design a protocol that could speak to the media server and integrate it with OBS. So why not just do it in a way that could be easily implemented by other media servers and hopefully be widely adopted for other software and hardware encoders? And that's really how WHIP, the WebRTC HTTP Ingest Protocol, was born. And yes, we have to admit that the main reason for choosing that name was solely to be able to include this picture in that blog article. And WHIP really, you know, in all seriousness, really solves the biggest pain point for WebRTC, which is media ingest. It hides all the WebRTC complexity and allows software like OBS, GStreamer, or FFmpeg, as well as hardware encoders, to implement support for WebRTC once and for all without compromising the nature of WebRTC end-to-end. And practically, it means that using the WebRTC stack, WebRTC.org, for example, and the open source WHIP library are all the things you need to support WebRTC on the sender side. The burden of WebRTC support is now really on the server side. And technically, WHIP is very similar to what we are already used to with WebRTC. It's just an HTTP post request to perform an SDP OA exchange, and then just rely on DTLS and ICE for controlling the connection state. That simplicity imposes quite a lot of restrictions for the usage, like not being able to do a renegotiation or add or remove tracks on the fly. But luckily, those restrictions fit perfectly well into the broadcasting world, where a single one-way stream is really the most typical use case. And to date, the open source Medus media server, created by our very own Sergio Garcia Murillo, and Janus server, created by our friend Lorenzo Mineiro, provide an implementation of this WHIP integration. On the client side, our OBS fork has a complete implementation, as well as our own Millicast Studio software encoder, which also has like a command line interface version. Implementing a WHIP client for the web browser was really easy as well. After all, you know, HTTP and WebRTC are web technologies, so why would it have to be any harder, right, than doing that for the web? And Sergio has also created an open source JavaScript client that is available on his GitHub page. Ticket's also been opened with GStreamer by one of their developers, and Lorenzo has created a GStreamer implementation that is available on his GitHub page. And our friends over at Osprey Video are implementing WHIP with GStreamer in their Talon 4K encoder that will be the first commercially available native WebRTC hardware encoder on the market, which is really, really exciting. Implementing WHIP on Medu's media server was really easy in the end, and Sergio explained it to me on how he did that. And he used Express or whatever preferred REST API framework you have to receive the HTTP POST request with the SDP offer, and it creates the transport and the incoming stream objects from it and returns the SDP answer. So it's easy peasy, right? And as I just outlined, the connection state can be monitored by checking the ICE and the DTLS state changes, and an abrupt disconnection can be detected by the ICE timeout event, which is driven by the consent freshness algorithm defined for WebRTC, and the DTLS state event for failed or stopped for detecting connection errors or normal disconnection. And you might be wondering yourself how hard it was to integrate WHIP into our own OBS WebRTC version. To be honest, it took more time writing the spec than it actually took adding support for it. The real pain point is not WHIP from a signaling layer. It really is the original lib WebRTC integration. And that's true, I think, of a lot of people who are considering adding this to their hardware or software devices. They're kind of restricted by chipsets and whatever software language they have, and being able to maintain that lib WebRTC version when they implement it into their architecture. So, you know, why are we doing this presentation at Demuxed, and really what's next for WHIP? Well, Sergio wrote a draft to the IETF, and his WHIP draft is currently being reviewed by the WISH group at IETF, and it will hopefully become ratified in a standard by the end of this year. Unfortunately, the WHIP name was already used sometime in the 1950s, I think, and hence the name of the group is the WISH group, which unfortunately for him, I know he's very disappointed, it will put an end to our Indiana Jones homages. So we're going to have to find a new image to use with the WISH group. But more importantly, and all joking aside, we really would love to see WHIP made available on more WebRTC media servers. I know Wowzer is currently considering adding support, and we would also love to see WHIP support added for more ingest tools like FFmpeg and GStreamer. And we've also been speaking to hardware encoder vendors like Teradek, Videon, Aja, about support for native WebRTC as well. I wrote an integration guide early this year that outlines the benefits, the potential feature support, and potential pitfalls of integrating WebRTC. And like I mentioned previously, the biggest pain point is definitely which WebRTC library to implement, depending on your hardware and software, whether you're using a Xilinx or a Qualcomm, Intel, you know, and so on and so forth. The upcoming IETF hackathon that's happening here in just a couple of weeks will focus on WHIP interoperability tests and continue to improve the current draft from field trials. And I know the Osprey video team will be joining to provide feedback on their own recent WHIP integration with a Talon 4K encoder. So, you know, what does this all mean? Well, I think with the pandemic forcing people to stay at home and businesses to reinvent themselves to provide interactive feeds and remote experiences, that can mimic real-life experiences. I think the live real-time segment is really enjoying a renewed surge in interest. So what the audience really wants is the same vibe that they would have in real life, interaction in the moment with the rest of the audience and with the performers. And really that requires better than live. It requires real-time streams. And I think WebRTC really is the answer that can be provided. And the more we can create these kind of media tools for ingesting and sharing and interoperability between all these different services, I think the more that's going to become a reality here in the very near future. So let's make it happen together with WebRTC and WHIP.